Good evening and welcome to In Your District. Tonight, we're in District 5 with Donna Reed. I'm Linda Kelleher, your host, and we hope you'll call in with your questions and comments at 610-378-0426. And also, we have a guest with us tonight. We have Nicole Bowman, who's the local leader for the Moms Demand Action Group. And we'll be speaking with her about her group and her need for volunteers a bit later. Donna, we're going to open, if you don't mind, with the Northwest Branch Library makeover. Yes. Long time coming.
It was a long time coming. That library, as you know, Linda, dates back to about 1939. It was actually built when there's a lot of change occurring in Northwest Reading. The Glenside homes were built around that time, and they brought a library branch out there, the Northwest Branch. It's a neat old building.
It is.
It's sort of a strangely built building when you think about it. But one of the catalysts for the change there is not only what we need, the change that we need in the community and changing society and the needs for more people to have the internet, I sound like I'm from 1999, have internet access, that they can use it for job searches, job training. Libraries have changed. They're not just books anymore. They're not just DVDs anymore. But to the credit of the Reading Library people, who have done a great job in modernizing the main branch and the southeast branch, mm-hmm. and I think there's been northeast with the heating situation, heating air conditioning situation.
Yeah, they're in the makeover process right now.
And some of it's capital money from the city of Reading because we fund the libraries to a degree. But in a case of the Northwest branch of the Reading Public Library, part of the catalyst for this change is not only meeting the changing needs that our community has, but also what will become the River Road Extension Project,
right,
which a lot of people have heard about. It will really kickstart starting in 2019, to my understanding. You will see a major, major change in terms of River Road / West Spring Street, whatever you'd like to call it, going into what used to be the old Dana site.
Right.
It will be a catalyst to finally get that skeleton down and get some development there. But the River Road Extension is designed to not only support economic development down there, but also to make it a safer area. You'll see a road, I believe it's Eckert Street or Lincoln Street, that will go through what is now known as the Windsor and Ritter Playground. Am I getting Windsor and McKnight? Windsor and Ritter?
Windsor
I call
and Ritter,
it,
yeah.
No, multiple things. If, as you know, it's owned by the school district. It has not really been maintained very well for a long, long time.
Yeah.
So that will actually become road access, and it will really facilitate not only truck traffic and commercial traffic out there, but also increase pedestrian safety and increase efficiencies of vehicular traffic. As part of that, one of the proposed configurations puts green space in front of the Northwest Library and a parking area as opposed to Bridge Street, which goes immediately down adjacent to the Schuylkill Avenue Bridge, which of course was recently redone the last 3 years. And because there will be some maybe difficulty with some vehicular access or challenges, let's put it challenges.
Changes.
There will still be parking off site there. But all these things have come together in a good, perfect storm to facilitate a more up-to-date, a more embracing of the Times library facility. And I give a lot of credit to the library board and to the leadership with Bronwyn. I never say her name wrong. I'm sorry. But anyhow, March 15th, it's the Ides of March, but it's not the Ides. It's a good day. March 15th at the Northwest Library from 5 to 6:30, there will be a meet and greet. The library folks will be there. They will have photos of the equipment, the plan layout. There'll be some refreshments there. There will be some folks from the city, myself included. I believe Stacy Taylor from the NAACP will be there, as well as other folks. So it will be a meet and greet primarily for the library, but we'll dovetail it into a sort of community meeting. I'll be asking Ralph to bring along the sketches for the River Road Extension, so people will understand how all this melts
together. Yeah.
And you know, we'll really do it in a way that it's not so much like, you know, three of us are sitting at the table and you're asking questions. We're just going to talk to each other. And if you have concerns in a district, that's what I'll be there for and others. But I think it's going to be really great. I think you're really going to learn a lot about the changes for the Northwest Library Branch And again, something really great happening in Northwest Reading.
So, wow.
Exciting.
That's good stuff. What type, did rats play a big role in, well, I shouldn't say rats, the Reading Area Transportation Study.
Yeah. It's always great to tell people I'm on a board called rats. Yeah. I've been on rats for years. But yeah, they've played a role, and they've played as we prioritize in a Reading Area Transportation Study Group. Their mission is to prioritize transportation projects throughout Berks County, not just City of Reading. And this has been one that has been on the books for a while. There is some
2008,
funding.
If I recall correctly.
Yeah, before I came back to council.
Yeah.
So it has been something that we've all worked on together with the county, with PennDOT, city, through different administrations, and I'm glad to see this is going forward. I think it's going to make a big difference out there, and I think it's going to, the parcel that has sat there, as many of you have been discouraged about it for years, so have we, but that 50-acre parcel will be much more marketable and much more attractive to developers when that River Road extension goes
especially
in.
With the new zoning overlay that's
exactly,
there.
Which we did so that we made sure that instead of one humongous big company, that there it is now zoned for what the original intent was for small companies, small offices, small warehousing, and also the residential component, because that property overlooks, it's a beautiful site, it overlooks the river, it overlooks into Wyomissing and West Reading.
Right.
It's a great site, right off Bear Park. For those of you who don't know, it's right behind Bear Park. It's right behind Northwest Elementary School, which is a brand new playground, thanks to the teachers and the community out there. So we're just real excited because good things are happening in Northwest Reading.
Yeah, absolutely.
All over in Reading, but my great fifth district, which I love.
The next great thing for overall Reading is what we heard about on Tuesday night at our committee meeting with MedEd, with their smart meter swap out.
Your electric meter is going to get smart now, so you know, encourage it, put a little graduation hat on it, a little mortarboard. Now, MedEd came to us and we appreciate it. It was one of the most complete presentations I think we've seen as a council for many years about a utility project that will impact everyone in Reading, because everyone has electricity and MedEd is our
provider
at this point. So what will happen is you will get a smart meter.
Right.
It will start in
2019,
next year, same with the River Road project. You will see a group called Wellington Energy.
Right.
That will, the trucks called Wellington Energy will be in the area. Everyone who comes to a property, be it commercial or residential, will knock on the door first, will introduce themselves. You'll see an identifying tag. So you know who it is. It's perfectly legitimate. Any questions, call the city, call city council. But these folks will be replacing your meters. You are not going to see what you've seen with the gas meters that have caused such
devastation.
Disarray. Yeah, devastation. We're using the D word. We should use perhaps a different word that starts with a later letter in the alphabet. But the devastation is caused not only in our city, but many cities, but with these gas meters that have been moved to the outside, people's yards have been dug up, streetscapes have been bastardized is a word I would use, and that's not a swear word, that's an okay adjective. And it's been a safety problem, because if any of you drive Schuylkill Avenue, you drive Cotton Street, our little streets where these gas meters, here's the street, and here's the sidewalk, and the gas meter comes within 2.5 feet of the street. It's not right. It's not good. And if a car goes into that, we're all in deep trouble. That was UGI. This is not UGI. I give MedEd all the credit in the world. These smart meters not only will be an update, they will enable you to understand your electrical usage, maybe budget it better with doing things like laundry at night, turning down your air conditioning when you're not home, all those kind of things that we know to be true. This will give you the readout, so you'll really be able to work with these smart meters. It's
daily.
Very encouraging. Yes, daily, you're right.
Yeah, because that meter read will transmit to MedEd as the electricity is consumed.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So it's going to be good stuff. Any questions you have, there's going to be an awful lot of education going on. MedEd committed that to us, both the council and the administration, that they will do a great amount of information education, both in English and Spanish, for our citizens, and we're mightily appreciative of them, because it's not something we always see, right, Linda?
Yeah, and they said, too, that the switch out will only take 5 minutes. your power probably won't be disrupted.
But they will notify you on the odd chance it could be that you have the opportunity.
And they're not moving your meter. Wherever the meter is, it's going to be located exactly the same place.
It's sort of like a facelift for the meter, but a new face.
Right. So instead of, in the future, the meter reader walking around the neighborhood collecting the data.
With their little.
Your smart meter will be transmitting that data right into the billing system.
We did not ask about the fate of the meter readers. So we're hopeful that those folks will be placed elsewhere in the
company.
Repurposed. I think it sort of seems like that, but that's certainly something we will ask as a follow-up, because there's a lot of good people. We don't want to see anyone lose a position, but MedEd has proven itself, I think, for those of us who have been around here for many years, to be a quality utility, and we have a lot of faith in them.
Yeah.
And they also redid the substation in Northwest Reading.
Yes, and on McKnight Scap Road.
Yes, in your district and in mine. So we thank them for the updates there, because that's good for power. You know, enhanced power,
less outages.
So another reason we sort of like good old MedEd. So thank you, MedEd. Now, if they would just bring their Ready, what was his name, the little mascot?
Oh, Ready Watts?
Yeah, so
like
you remember the little lightning bolt mascot when we were kids? So if they bring him back, we're good.
Yeah.
So anyhow.
Well, let's talk about Moms Demand Action. Nicole, tell us about your group, what it does, what you're trying to accomplish.
Sure. So Moms Demand Action is a national grassroots organization that advocates for common sense gun laws. And I started a local Berks County chapter of this just a few months ago. But Moms Demand Action is everywhere. It's all across the nation. And it is actually under the umbrella of an organization called Every Town for Gun Safety that was started by Michael Bloomberg, which provides the infrastructure that provides like research and data and a lot of like political think tank information. And then Moms Demand Action are like the feet on the ground, the volunteers in the states. All across the country, like I said, and it was actually founded, Moms Demand Action was founded by a mother 5 years ago. Her name was Shannon Watts, and she started it in the wake of the Sandy Hook school shooting.
Okay.
And it was her way to start doing something about making common sense gun laws. So it's grown since then, and I think there are maybe 2 million volunteers now in the country. And so in Pennsylvania, there are about, well, when we started, there were maybe like 5 chapters, but in the last week, this has really kind of struck a nerve with people since the shooting in Parkland. Mm-hmm. And people are really, really getting involved in, I think there are even more chapters being started like every day. So we had our first official meeting. We've had a lot of unofficial meetings with moms that I know since last spring. But our first official member meetup was actually Tuesday of this week. And normally there are about 5 of us who come. I invite everyone and we do our best to promote what we're doing. But this time we expected that there was a buzz. We expected a lot of people, maybe 20. But we had more than 100 people come.
Wow.
Yeah, and we met at a church, and we had to move rooms because people couldn't fit in. And, you know, there were people in the hallway, and it was...
That's fabulous.
Yeah,
that's fabulous.
It was amazing. I was surprised because people came ready to help and totally fully engaged with great ideas. Connecting me already, here I am talking about this. So, you know, we have lots of great people who really seem to want to volunteer, and which is awesome because right now there's a priority bill in Pennsylvania called State Bill 501, and it's a domestic violence bill. So what it would do is close a really dangerous loophole, so that those who are convicted of domestic abuse and have a PFA against them, right now they have 60 days to relinquish their firearms.
Oh.
And they can give it to any third party. So right now they could give it to a friend, a neighbor, a brother, a father, anyone. And in fact, it's not even upheld in most cases, I think it's only upheld by a judge in one of seven cases for them to even relinquish it. So this law, this state bill 501 would close that loophole, and it would make sure that if you're convicted of domestic abuse, you have 48 hours to relinquish your gun, and you have to give it to a licensed gun dealer or sheriff or someone like that. And it would also make sure that that's enforced and carried through. So right now that bill is in committee, in the Judiciary Committee, but we're really, Moms Demand Action has, in Pennsylvania, this is a priority to advocate for passing this bill because, as we know, domestic violence is very strongly linked with gun violence and homicide. So I think that in Pennsylvania alone, out of all the women who are murdered, half of them are killed by an intimate partner. So, yeah.
Those are scary statistics. Yeah. And I think we've all either known someone or unfortunately had neighbors or someone. Mm-hmm. So certainly domestic violence is something that touches everyone. But as you said, the catalyst for the increase in the movement was the Parkland shooting, and certainly the student movement down there, which is totally admirable, and how it's been catching on quickly. Yeah. And I thought it was interesting because I think something that we can all, and all three of us here are moms, that we can all agree on is the concern about the assault weapons and the availability of them. And I saw a post today on Facebook that I think reaches home in a way that all the other, quote, political and posts haven't. And this is from a medical person, and you've probably seen this one, down at one of the hospitals in Parkland where the kids were treated. And I'm just going to read this because this is like serious. If this doesn't give you chills, I don't know what will. This is, again, from a doctor in the medical community down there. And here's the quote. Quote, I was looking at a CT scan of one of the victims of the shooting at Marjory Stoneman Douglas High School, who had been brought to the trauma unit during my call shift. The organ looked like an overripe melon smashed by a sledgehammer with extensive bleeding. How could a gunshot wound have caused this much damage? The reaction in the emergency room was the same. One of the trauma surgeons opened a young victim in the operating room and found only shreds of the organ that had been hit by a bullet from an AR-15, a semi-automatic rifle which delivers a devastatingly lethal high-velocity bullet to the victim. There was nothing left to repair, and utterly devastating, nothing that could be done to fix the problem. The injury was fatal. I can't imagine how these parents are dealing with this, how the children sitting next to someone who was shot was dealing with this. There's no reason in the world why a weapon like that should be in anyone's hands.
Oh.
I'm sorry, in no one's hands. I believe that to be true, and I stand up, I think as many of us, as millions upon tens of millions of people do with the kids down there who are marching to make the difference. And I applaud your group for, number one, coming out and growing. I would love to have been there. Our council meeting ran till 8 o'clock. Had it not, I would have been there. And I know that many of your group may be going to Washington, as I will be on March 24th, but I know that you're starting to think about developing a march here or a rally here in Reading.
Mm-hmm.
And our council mate, Marsha Goodman Henderschitz, who is celebrating a birthday today, so there's always bright spots, who is not here, has volunteered to help you guys pull diverse groups together. Mm-hmm. So I think that's very important. And we do have a home viewer, so.
Hello.
Yeah, good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening.
What can we do for you?
I'll comment on what Donna just said. The statement by that healthcare provider down in Florida, the reasonings he was seeing, what he was seeing when the images that he was looking at is the M16 and the AR-15 are weapons that are rifled backwards, meaning when the projectile that comes out of it spins once it hits the target, and therefore, you know, it starts to cut and mash and whatever. Something literally can go in somebody's chest and come out the top of their head. And that kind of weapon has no place on our streets. That is a war-style weapon. It should be left there. I think they should ban it for public use, and that's my personal opinion. I am a Second Amendment supporter. But I think collectively we've got to start to talk about banning some of these weapons, passing policies where this doesn't happen to our schools. We actually guard our money better than we do our schools.
You're correct.
So.
And Ernie, you served in the military, so you know a little bit what you're discussing here.
Correct, yes. I served 8 years in the Army National Guard, and so I thought I would give my knowledge about what that weapon is.
And you're also a parent, so you can feel what we all feel here today.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ernie.
Bye-bye.
So we only have a little bit of time left. Mm-hmm. If our viewers want to get involved with your organization, what should they do?
Sure. Well, they should absolutely, first thing to do would be to text READY to 64433, and that will join you with Moms Demand Action, where you will not receive solicitations or tons of texts, but you will receive information about local things you can be doing, and you will be able to also get information about our local events. We have two upcoming events in Berks County in March, and you can look those up at momsdemandaction.org. And if you're a student and you want to get involved, you can text STUDENT to 64433. And locally, like you were saying, the March for Our Lives Sister March, that's being initiated by students here and supported by some local organizations. That is happening. I'll be going to Washington also. But we'll be supporting those local students who want to march, and we'll be doing some voter registration for young people. We're very inspired by these young people, and we need to listen to them. So, That's what we can do.
You know, and Linda and I are from a different generation. I'm a bit older than you are, but certainly in the 60s and 70s, my parents wouldn't let me do it. But in the 70s, I was down there marching in Washington in a couple of different, what I thought were large-scale marches, which compared to the women's march that I marched in last year, were nothing, because that women's march was enormous.
Wow.
Millions upon millions. It was so tight on Independence Avenue and Pennsylvania Avenue that between you and I, there would have probably been three people, and between us, there would have been two. We were literally marching, and it was stunning, and it was wonderful. And, you know, I'm respecting BCTV's point of reference. We're not to be political here. But I think saving lives, and I think advocating for our kids, and I think understanding that, in this case, the youth of this country has had enough. They've had enough of seeing their friends victimized, whether it's little ones in Sandy Hook, older ones who are now approaching middle age, who saw it in Columbine, people that have seen it on Army bases, people that have seen it in other schools, Virginia Tech in 2007. You can go on and on and on. And I give credit here to the Reading School District, because it was announced today that they're enhancing the numbers of cameras and vigilance at Reading High School, which we're proud of. It's a wonderful school, but I agree with the school board and Dr. Mumin for doing that. But for those of us who grew up at a time of change, who are now boomers, who are now retirement age, unfortunately we're that far ahead, but we're there, you know, we remember the passion and the activism and the energy of those early 70s. I dug out an old pin that I had from college that said, "We have had enough." Mm. Every now and then I pull this pin out. It's 40 odd years old, but I pull it out because it says is what we should all feel. If you've had enough of the status quo, and this goes from local government, and it can be municipal issues, to what is now at the forefront of the of national issues, if you have had enough, there are ways you can make change. You can peacefully demonstrate in the streets. You can exercise your freedom of speech. And you can do the most good by going to that ballot box, that polling place on election day, and casting your ballot for whom you think will be able to legislatively make those changes you want to see happen. If you want to see a ban on assault rifles, elect people that you know are not beholden to any particular group. If you want to see changes like you had talked about with House bills, there are people in place who are doing that. I don't care if they're, you know, the Donald Duck Party or the Mickey Mouse Party. That makes no never mind. Or, as my father would say in Pennsylvania Dutch, Mox Nix. Do what's right. our kids, if we can't protect our kids, then we leave no legacy at all. You know, whether you're a parent, whether you're not a parent, we're all moms here. And I know we would go to the end of the earth for our kids. All of us would. And that's the way it should be, and our grandchildren. But even if you're not a parent, we know that the future lies with our kids. From the little ones to the ones who are in high school, the ones who are in college. You're young. Thank you for stepping up. We're so glad to see people in your generation doing it. Yeah. And do what you can in a civic life, but never discount maybe an elective life where you can make a difference in a legislative capacity. But really, folks, enough's enough. We don't need any more dead children. We don't need assault weapons in any school, in any home, on the streets of whether it's Reading or Upper Burn Township. We don't need that stuff. You know, we need to talk things through. We need to be good to each other. And, you know, this program's called In Your District, but we all live in this universe, in this country.
That's a big district.
And much bigger than any of us will ever be representing. But it is folks like this lady sitting here that are going to lead the way as our generation sort of steps back and says, it's your turn. And
thanks.
Thank you for leading
thank
the way, because you're a little older than the students, but you're that great bridge. So we look forward to working with you and doing what we can. When you have more information about the march, and I know Marsha will be reaching out to you, we certainly will be willing to put not only on our personal Facebook pages, but certainly on our City Council Facebook page and
our newsletter.
Also, and I'm sure, I can't imagine there would be any issues. I'm sure the city administration will be happy to work with you guys in terms of the planning and the logistics, and we'll do what we can. Marsha will be a good bridge for you there.
Okay, great.
Right, and the bridge, you keep saying that word, the bridge I'm picking up from Nicole is it's not challenging the Second Amendment.
No.
What it's saying is common sense.
Yes, no one's fighting the Second Amendment.
Moms Demand Action supports the Second Amendment. Mm-hmm. It's just common sense.
Absolutely.
And that's a good place to start.
Yeah.
Yes. And one place we'd like to stop here is on a happy, happy note, because we don't know for sure, but at some point very, very near, or maybe it's happened or in the next few hours, our council mate, Lucine Sahilnik, will be welcoming, along with her husband, a brand new little baby boy into the world. And we're going to call him our junior councilman from District 1. So whether you're here or not, baby boy, we can't wait to meet you. And also, a happy birthday to my council bestie, Marsha Goodman Hinterschitz. We're all in this together, and we have a lot of serious things, but we want to be happy, too, right?
With the 1 minute we have.
One minute.
Why don't you talk a little bit about the resolution that we passed on Tuesday night at the special session?
We did, and that resolution will apply to council members. It's the it applies for maternity leave.
FMLA.
For up to 6 months, FMLA, family leave. Many of us have children, elders that we're responsible for, and it gives us, it really falls in line with what our HR policy is for the city, but it extends it to council. And in Lucine's absence, you can call any of us. We'll be glad to help out with District 1. Linda can sort of assign us. We can split up all the duties, but we wish Lucine nothing but the best, and it's so exciting. Younger people like yourself coming into elective office, bringing new life, both in terms of policy and energy, as well as literally a new life and joy into the city of Reading.
Right. Well, thank you for joining us, Nicole.
Thank you.
Donna,
thank you.
We look forward to working with you in the future.
Absolutely. Okay. Thanks,
great.
Nicole.
Thank you.
All right. Have a good night.
Good night, everyone.
Bye.
So, newsletter-wise,